Welcome to Hong Kong. I think it's an excellent opportunity for me to talk about growth and inequality in Hong Kong amid the Occupy Central movement, which is still ongoing and has been here with us for more than a month. Many protesting students who demand full democracy in Hong Kong share one belief, that is the social upward mobility has greatly reduced as compared to their parents' generation. Many believe now opportunities only belong to children of well-off families, which is not the case in their parents' generation, as students were told how the old generation ascended from poor public housing residents to become able to buy their own flats and even become executives in multinationals or local blue chips companies. So the students believe inequality exists the moment when one is born, and more importantly, no matter how hard one studies and works, the rich will only be richer and the poor poorer, because the government always colludes with local tycoons and the power elites from China. Therefore, the students think full democracy is the way to end the collusion, and that's why we have the protest now. In a way, their observation is correct. Their parents had way more opportunities in the 1980s, but I would argue their parents also had way more opportunities than their grandparents, because the transitional period before the handover in 1997 is exceptional. The British ruling class was retreating, as well as the local elites, who lacked the confidence of the communist takeover. Their departure naturally created lots of senior managerial positions for young people to pick up, especially at the backdrop of a reforming China, where both the world and China require lots of services from Hong Kong to facilitate their trade. The situation I just described is exceptional, and no way, even with full democracy, any government can replicate. Using this exceptional period as a benchmark and complain they lack upward mobility, the students are not entirely fair, though they deserve some sympathy from us. Another reason of perceived inequality by some Hong Kong people, meaning the rich getting richer and the poor getting poorer, is that ongoing globalization has no doubt transferred some unskilled labor jobs from Hong Kong to neighboring developing countries, and at the same time enriched a relatively small number of entrepreneurs who are able to capitalize this globalization trend. Therefore, in Hong Kong, we witness the unskilled laborers struggle because they lost the competition with their peers in the developing countries. It's no doubt from the perspective of these individuals, they see harm and inequality bring forth by globalization. Yet, a moral question to ask is, to protect these low-skilled workers in Hong Kong who already have enjoyed basics like uninterrupted electricity supply, clean water, shelters, more than adequate protein intake, is it justifiable and moral to reverse globalization by the means of protectionism, such that the end result is sending back girls in India, for instance, from factories back to brothels who deserve the help more? So to conclude, for the case of Hong Kong and many also applicable to other countries, my question is, when dealing with poverty or inequality, how far should the government go? Should the government only deal with absolute poverty? Is government capable of dealing with the kind of relative inequality I just mentioned that exists in Hong Kong? Or should the government do even less? When we heard Fred just said central banks are printing money and create the kind of inequality that we are experiencing, should they do less? Or should they make less law so that, because we know that many laws benefit the incumbent, the big multinationals, versus the small and medium enterprise. So I think it's the end of my presentation and time for you to raise questions and more, you know, give me some clue how we can resolve the current situation.
Thank you. You know, I have questions. Yeah. The first one, do you have data about Gini coefficient in Hong Kong, before tax and after tax?
Well, it has been, in our media, they have been saying that Hong Kong's Gini coefficient is one of the worst,
in the world. But that is before tax. But after tax, how will it?
Let me finish my story. So they would say, our
so that was the first signal.
It's actually worse than some African countries. Maybe.
To move on to the discussion.
Whatever. But I would argue to compare the Gini coefficient in this city state versus America is unfair. I mean, when you look at our Gini coefficient compared with New York City, way worse Gini coefficient compared to Hong Kong. So, I mean, some socialists just want to make the case that Hong Kong is very unfair. But I mean, among big cities, our Gini coefficient is actually not that bad. And actually, I think there is also fundamental flaw within Gini coefficient. I don't think whether North Korea would have a Gini coefficient measure, but
their Gini must be very good.
Yeah, must be zero.
But my question is, I'm not trying to occupy a monopoly question, but a very good question. But assuming you income inequality problem is a need to fix, then in that case, especially Hong Kong middle income class, how much tax increase are they willing to bear?
Of course, without the government tried to, at least some politicians try to change our simple tax system into some more complicated one, and they tried to introduce VAT in Hong Kong several years ago. They failed, but so without the real threat of income tax, will be going up. The middle class tend to say that, I don't mind to pay, a few percentage point more. But I think it's just because the threat, they cannot see the threat. When government talk about increasing another type of tariffs, not in the form of tax, but tariffs, they will come out and complain. So I mean, they're just generous. They're just paying lip service. But going back to fixing our situation in Hong Kong, if you go to New York City also have huge inequality. But how they deal with it is the people in New York City, if they cannot afford life there, they could move to New Jersey.
That's right. Yeah.
But in Hong Kong, we did not have this option.
Used to be, but now,
for the old generation, it's better because they came from the north, and the culture they are more easily to get in. But for the younger generation, it's pretty difficult. In the past there were some discussion. We counter colonize the north, meaning to expand the territory of Hong Kong. They once talked about integrating Shenzhen into Hong Kong. So now it's getting, because of the political sentiment here, the conflicts between mainland Chinese as well as Hong Kong, so that proposal is now largely ignored. But still, as a think tank, my proposal is to make the boundary of Hong Kong bigger, so people they can move around. If you have new development in our northern border, people can move there and work. That's how you solve the inequality problem.
I was at the Occupy Central yesterday with some others.
Yeah,
and to me, these are of course factors, the inequality or the perception of it, and many other perhaps economic issues. But the fundamental at the core is not that. I think the reason why I would completely sympathize with what's happening there is because no freedom can exist without the freedom to express. No freedom can exist. And Hong Kong, because of its British heritage and the rule of law, has enjoyed a tremendous freedom of expression. I think to answer your last question, coming from the largest democracy in the world and where protests are normal, if only that park next to the Lechko was allowed to the protesters, like in Delhi, we have within half a kilometer of Delhi, of Indian Parliament, a place reserved for anybody from India to come and protest, you know, as long as they are non-violent. And these protesters probably have been the most civic-minded protests people can see anywhere. So I don't care so much about what their economic ideologies or philosophies might be, because I had a little bit of chat with some of them. But that this, to me, needs complete support if we can withstand. And I think Radim said he had a very important, interesting point at T. What he said was, the reason we support this is because the only institution that has made Hong Kong what it is and can sustain Hong Kong what it is rule of law. And if we don't sustain this freedom to express, the judiciary will get compromised. It will just be a matter of time.
It's a very good question or challenge. They are doing the right thing for a very wrong reason, I would say. I respect their freedom to speak up. And you're right. In order to upkeep Hong Kong as the international financial center, it's all about, you know, freedom to express yourself. People, like, there are talks about Shanghai taking over Hong Kong. I think this is nonsense, because you don't have freedom of speech.
Exactly.
The information cannot flow freely. Exactly. No, it can't be. It can't be the international financial center. So I mean, I'm not saying that I have no.
Sorry to interrupt, but just to inform you that there's 1 minute left before the participant moves to another country.
And you're right. That's why they can hold on there. Even you see more tents than people, but they still can hold on for more than a month, which means they do have support. And Hong Kong people are sensible. You know, letting the kids having camp outside Lechko, the main road, for a month, would now, you know, the opposition is increasing, but still, we let them, you know, camp outside the Legislative Council. So I see the prospect of Hong Kong. We still have hope. You know, Hong Kong people are open-minded. But it's just the government, the propaganda machine, is saying all the bad things about the occupied sexual movement. It's not completely wrong.
But you know, I compared, that I was just saying to Razin, that to me the comparison is between Singapore and Hong Kong, because Singapore is a small city, Hong Kong is a small city, more or less a similar population and all that. And both are very high on economic freedom.
Yeah.
One factor is, of course, rule of law. The other is, and which is probably makes me more attractive to Hong Kong.
So you might want to take a visit and have a look at this question with the other country hosts who are waiting for you.
Because when you have dispute with the Singaporean
government,
you have
no chance
to win. But yeah, you have dispute with the Hong Kong government.
I'll give around 1 minute time for the participants to move from one country to another, then I will start time up further, another 5 minutes again.